Good morning and welcome to the second meeting in 2023 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. Thank you. We now turn to agenda item 2, which is to take evidence from the Minister for Environment and Land Reform on our post-legislative scrutiny of Part 9 of the Communities Empowerment Act 2015. Last year, we undertook an inquiry and published a report on Part 9 of the 2015 Act. The Scottish Government has responded to that report, and this is our chance to explore that response further. We are joined today by Mary McCallan, Minister for Environment and Land Reform from the Scottish Government. And Ms McCallan is accompanied in person today by James Hamilton, who is the branch head at Food and Drink Trade, the Scottish Government Legal Directorate, and Tracy McConlin, who is the head of the Good Food Nation team at the Scottish Government. And online, joined by Simon Bonsall, who is the senior planner Planning, Architecture and Regeneration Division at the Scottish Government. And I warmly welcome our witnesses to the meeting and invite the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for inviting myself and my colleagues today. Thanks also for your time and for the committee's time in looking at this important matter. I very much welcome the work that your committee have done and the recommendations that you've produced, and I've take them all on board. And I say that because local growing is very important to the Scottish Government. I think the 2015 Act itself, Part 9, I think that demonstrates the importance that we place on allotments as part of that wider picture of community growing. And I mention the wider picture because I'm glad that your investigation looked both at allotments but also the non-statutory growing environment. I'm absolutely committed and convinced of the multiple benefits of community growing. You set out a number of these in your report: physical and mental health, social cohesion, biodiversity, reducing carbon footprint, and tackling, I think, loneliness and isolation. And I think you put it aging well or aging healthily, which I think was really important. I believe in those co-benefits, and I also believe that they should be something that everyone in Scotland can access. And I think a lot of what the work we're doing here will help us progress that. However, we have been living through a recent period of disruption. In many ways, I think that has only served to make those co-benefits much more important. We know that people turned to their natural environment as they took solace in some of the darkest days of the pandemic, and equally as we were able to unlock, people sought that cohesion and the coming together after the separation of lockdown. But of course, that disruption has also created a period of difficulty for governance and implementation and delivery, both locally and nationally. I think when Part 9 was passed, none of us could probably have foreseen the events that would follow. So just to conclude, Convener, I just want to make two final points on that issue of delivery. Firstly, it is that the Scottish Government clearly have responsibilities under Part 9 of the Act. These have been fulfilled by the letter of the legislation. The vast majority of the responsibilities lie with local authorities, who I believe are best placed to make decisions based on their local demography, geography, resource. I think the Scottish Government, and I want the Scottish Government to be a helpful broker of progress on that, but I don't want to impinge on local decision making. And then the second point on delivery is a practical one. I just want to flag, and we cannot escape, the very difficult financial restrictions that local and national government are facing just now. But I hope that despite that, with the good work of the committee that I want to take on board and take away, I hope that we can make progress in the months and years to come. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much for that, Mary. I, having been involved in community growing for many years, both here in Scotland but also in New York City, I'm sure that where there's a will, there's a way. And if the opportunities are made clearer for people, both through government leadership but also through the local authority leadership, I think we'll find those that opportunity for those co-benefits that you've outlined. I'm going to open with questions now. So thinking about the broad impact of Part 9 of the bill, do you feel that there's adequate data available to say whether or not the legislation has been a success? And if so, what impact do you think Part 9 of the Act has had over its 5 years of implementation? And obviously you've identified the co-benefits and things like that, but just to hear a bit more from you.
Yeah, I think first of all, on the impact, I think there's no doubt that there are individual examples, a substantial number of individual examples where the Act has had a positive impact, not just through what the Act itself has allowed local authorities to do and communities to benefit from, but equally we need to accept there's a signalling effect to a government creating primary legislation which makes these obligations and rights and responsibilities very clear. However, some years down the line, we cannot be blind to the fact that there are some ways in which things don't appear to have worked as we had expected. Waiting lists are long and they are growing. Availability of land, as you have identified, remains a problem. And I know that the committee see that the disparity of experience remains a problem. On that latter point, I think that yes, that could be, but equally I'm mindful of the need to recognise the different experiences in different local authorities across the country. We will all come from different parts of the country where we'll see different need, and we need to remember that local authorities are dealing with different situations. Your first point was about data gathering. There are not, the Act does not place duties on the Scottish Government to collect data or to benchmark that data. I am open-minded to the idea that could be explored. And I think you had suggested that the annual allotment reports might be a suitable place to do that. And I will consider whether that's doable and what the benefits of that would be to local authorities and to Scottish Government.
Thank you. And that's really helpful that you are open to consider some form of collecting data and benchmarking it. Moving on to local authorities and provisioning, there's clearly a huge unmet demand for allotments across local authorities. What can the Scottish Government do if councils fail to meet their statutory duties in terms of provision, waiting lists and food growing strategies? And why do you think some councils are fulfilling these duties and others aren't? Is there more adequate resourcing required to support local authorities to do so?
Well, I think, again, just to take the last point first, local authorities are facing different situations. Something as basic as having a geography which allows more people to have their own gardens is going to make a difference as compared with an urban local authority dealing with fewer instances of that. So they're certainly dealing with different local circumstances and different demand. And the need to make resource decisions about that and where to place funding as part of the block grant. Very cut and dry. Ultimately, if statutory duties are not met by a local authority, in theory it is possible to bring legal proceedings to be lodged against that local authority. But I say that only as a matter of fact. That is not something that the Scottish Government would want to pursue. We should far rather work with local authorities, with COSLA if need be, to work out constructively how we make progress together. And I think there's a number of ways that we can do that, continuing with the tripartite group, considering whether additional guidance would be helpful. I'm conscious that we produced guidance on food growing strategies, but haven't done similarly on allotment reports. And I think I can accept that might be a reason why there have been difficulties there. We talked about considering benchmarking data and also things like easing regulation on permitted development rights. These are all tools I think that the Scottish Government has, but ultimately there is a legal power to bring proceedings, although we wouldn't want to go there.
Okay, thanks very much. I mean, I think what you're pointing out there with the additional guidance could be good, and that's something we talked about in the report, is the need for some leadership. And I'm certainly aware that I can imagine when a local authority is busy doing the work that it needs to do and then it needs to take something new on. It's like, how do you start to get into that new work stream? And guidance can always help ease the way. I'd like to focus on the role of the coming Scottish Food Commission. In the government response to the committee's report, it notes the links between the local Good Food Nation plans and the food growing strategies, and that those are there. They're there for the local authorities to determine. But given our very welcome move towards more sustainable locally grown food, I'm keen to hear what thoughts the Scottish Government have had on the Commission's role in Part 9 of the Community Empowerment Act, somehow creating a link. I know that Good Food Nation plans require local authorities it's about procurement to their public kitchens, whereas Part 9 of the Community Empowerment Act is more about local food community growing and that kind of thing. But I think there's a connection there, or there needs to be a connection, because what I notice is that there's confusion. Mm-hmm. And so if we don't make that connection, then there can be confusion.
Okay, no, I think it's a good point, and I will probably hand over to my colleague Tracy to say a bit more about that, given her heading up the Good Food Nation team. I suppose, just for my part, firstly, I see local food growing and the provision of it, both in a statutory sense and more widely, as being part of local Good Food Nation planning. That in a very practical sense, in that a food growing strategy under Part 9 could form part of what a local authority then produces as its local Good Food Nation plan, but equally just generally that the provision of good opportunity for local growing is part of our vision for a Good Food Nation. And I think, if I remember correctly, there is statutory provision under the Good Food Nation Act for Scottish Government and local authorities to work together on guidance for the production of the local Good Food Nation plans. But I'm sure Tracy will correct me if I'm wrong on that. But Tracy, do you want to say a little bit more about the interplay between them, please?
Yes, to pick up the last point first, in terms of guidance, that was one of the things that was considered during the progress of the bill through Parliament. And I don't think it would necessarily be guidance. I think there needs to be a discussion as to what would be most useful, as to whether guidance is the best way to go or whether there's other ways that the Scottish Government and local authorities could work together in the developing of their plans. And obviously at the moment, the National Good Food Nation Plan is under development. We'll be learning lessons as we go along with that. And those will feed into the discussions that we'll have with local authorities when they're undergoing the process of developing their own plans. And to respond to the question about the Food Commission and their role, and the Food Commission within the Good Food Nation Act is very tightly linked to the plans themselves. So that would be the role that the Food Commission would have. It would be in reviewing the Good Food Nation plans either at a national or a local level. And the legislation is very tightly linked to that. So that would be their role there. So if there is something within those plans about allotments, community food growing, local food, then that would be part of the mix of their review.
Thank you for that. So if there is such a thing as a plan hierarchy, from what I'm hearing you say, so correct me if I've picked it up wrongly, that probably what would happen is a Good Food Nation plan would sit above, and the local food strategy coming out of the Part 9 would be of the Community Empowerment Act would sit with underneath it. Is that how it would fit?
But perhaps James wants to come in. Okay. Certainly what I was trying to say in the beginning, convener, is largely what you've described there. I wouldn't want to say underneath, just part of. Just as a reflection of the fact that local growing is part of our plans for a Good Food Nation, of which there are other facets.
Yes.
James.
I would echo that. I would describe them as complementary. So I think Good Food Nation plans, we're looking for local authorities to set out some outcomes that they want to achieve. And then it also has to set out the policies that the local authority intends to pursue in order to achieve those outcomes. And that could have an overlap with the food growing strategy, where the local authority will set out how it intends to increase the provision in its area of allotments. But before the Good Food Nation plan has to include the provision of allotments, the local authority would have to decide for itself that was one of the outcomes that it wanted to achieve. And there's also a question for government as to whether the Scottish Government has to specify functions which local authorities have to have regard to when they carry out those functions, they have to have regard to their own good food nation plan. So the other question that, that obviously we're looking at the moment is whether we would specify as one of those functions the food grown strategy that requires to be prepared by a local authority under section 119 in part 9. So I don't think I would describe them as having a hierarchy that the Good Food Nation plans would take priority. I think they're very much complementary, and depending on how government works to implement the Good Food Nation plans and how local authorities work to implement the Good Food Nation plans, there's a very good chance that the two plans will be complementary to each other.
Thanks very much for that. All right, we're going to move on to another area. I'm going to bring in Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister and panel.
Morning.
During its inquiry, the committee got a chance to get out and meet with organisations and individuals who are making a real difference in their local communities and are very passionate about the importance of food growing. We recommended this is harnessed into a national forum to drive improvement. How soon will the Scottish Government reach a decision on the creation of such a forum?
Thank you for the question, and I would just echo your initial comments and the opportunity that I've had to meet folks who have either started or have long-running community growing organisations, but that I've met because they have done so under the land reform legislation, support with the Scottish Land Fund, etc. I would say I've met more of those groups than I have who have done so under statutory allotment work, and that's probably something for me to reflect on as well in the context of all of this. But they are some of the most enthusiastic and excellent groups that I've got the pleasure to meet. On the National Partnership Forum, so I have kind of viewed what the committee was saying here from some comments that I think you took on the tripartite group and its remit. I'm quite keen that that remains quite a tight group with SG, with local authorities, and with, I always forget what SAG stands for, the Scottish Association of Growing...
Allotments Gardens.
Allotments Gardens, yes, exactly. And I'm keen that that remains quite a tight group. However, I am interested in what the committee recommended with a national partnership forum. We already fund Grow Green Scotland to the tune of about £20,000 per annum, to coordinate the community growing forum. So I think what I'll do and what my officials and I will do is go away and consider the extent to which that role that they are currently undertaking is akin to what the committee has recommended as regards a national forum, and see how, you know, whether that role is already being fulfilled or what changes might be required or desirable.
Thank you.
Thanks, Marie. And I'm just, you know, in your opening statement, Minister, you said that obviously delivery is a challenge at this time with public finances. But I'd be interested to know if you did take forward a national forum, which I do think is a really important element in bringing people together. Has the Scottish Government taken into account the cost for establishing a national forum? You mentioned there that the Grow Green initiative is funded to £20,000 a year, but have you looked at the cost for a national forum?
Yes, yeah, so the figure is £19,800 per annum, and no, not yet, is the answer. I need to consider that, and it will require quite careful consideration, not just about the costings, but equally the value of it, both to Scottish Government and to local authorities. But I think what I'm saying as of today is that there is a considerable bit of work already underway, backed by annual funding of nearly £20,000, which I think we would agree is not insignificant in these circumstances. So I want to go away, compare what's being done just now against that which the committee has suggested, and consider what the gap is and how we might fill it if it's going to be beneficial.
Thanks very much. I think we very much appreciate your willingness to take on that piece of work. I'm now going to move on to a question from Annie Wells, who's joining us online.
Good morning, Convener. Good morning, Minister. I'm sort of staying on the same sort of issue of funding. Many community organisations told us that they still face a yearly battle for funding for ongoing projects that are proven to make a huge difference to people's lives. Does the Minister agree that sustaining existing projects is just as important as funding innovation? And what steps is the Scottish Government taking to address this and ensure funding can be accessed for ongoing projects?
Thank you, Ms Wells. Yes, I sort of receive two different concerns when I speak to groups across the piece. One is that they can't get new funding, and one is that new funding appears to be all that's available. So I think that there is concerns on both sides. But I do know that the issue of the reliability of funding and the ability to plan ahead that comes with multi-year funds is something that community and the third sector are calling out for. Of course, the Scottish Government itself has to work on an annual basis, and we're doing so just now in very volatile economic circumstances. But as with much of this, I am absolutely prepared to go away and to consider how we can strive for more stable multi-year funding patterns, because I know how that allows groups to plan. And I think that the fairer funding practice should be adopted as far as practically possible, and I'll certainly aim for that.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks, Annie. I'm now going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Good morning.
Today, you've already outlined where you think the committee's work can make a difference, but I just wondered specifically whether or not the Scottish Government intend to review the Community Empowerment Act, including Part 9, and to take on board some of the issues we've put forward.
So it's a good question. Obviously, it's quite a wide-ranging act, and you'll know that it's my colleague Tom Arthur, who is in his ministerial role, undertaking the commitment to review the Act. A lot of work on Part 9 had already started in advance of the commissioning of the review that Tom Arthur is taking forward. However, it's very much my intention to... We meet regularly anyway. In fact, just last week we had a cross-ministerial meeting on food, including Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, colleagues from local government. But it's certainly my intention now to specifically meet with Tom Arthur and to discuss the recommendations both of your report and our reply, so that can be insofar as possible built into his review.
Good. That's helpful, thank you. And an issue which I wanted to raise, which I've raised with you in the chambers, with regards to auditing potential land which could be available, and especially with regards to public sector bodies, NHS have a significant estate which could be potentially seem to be allocated for this use, and some organisations are doing that, but I just wondered what plans there are within government to try to have that audit, to then ask public sector bodies to allow allotments to be developed, because there seems to be a bit of a closed gate situation at the minute for a lot of people who have come to me, especially here in the capital, trying to access land which is owned by public bodies.
Okay. I don't currently have any plans for an audit. But that doesn't mean that I'm not sympathetic to the view that public bodies should very much consider the scope to allow their land to be used in this way. I know that the question of whether the Act itself should be extended to include some other public bodies is something that was considered. I don't think that's necessary just now, because and you know, particularly coming from the land reform portfolio, I see that we already have a suite of right to buy mechanisms which apply to public private land, and you know, to buy abandoned or neglected ground, to do further sustainable development, crofting right to buy, and negotiated purchases and sales which happen outside of the Act. So I see an environment just now with quite a lot of opportunity for that, and for that reason I don't currently think that public bodies or that the Act should be extended beyond local authorities.
Okay, thank you for that. I think one of the points which we did hear was that, you know, there are these opportunities, but the finance to achieve that is not there, or it's to come from local authorities who then will not have it. So I think there is that financial a problem for many people to then be able to take forward some of these bits of legislation. But I take on board what you've said, and I think it would be helpful to investigate potentially where public sector bodies are even having this on their agenda to take it forward, and some who should be having a, like the NHS, an agenda to try to promote well-being and get people into these sorts of activities, surely would want to try to release some land to do that. So, helpful answer, and thanks for your time this morning.
Thank you. I take that on board. Thank you.
Smiles. Yes, I mean, I do see around my region there are pockets of places where NHS have allowed community growing on their land. I've certainly see this lovely project called the I think it's a sensory garden in Tarbert. But maybe that's a piece of work around the guidelines and that leadership of signalling more clearly that this is something that we really want to see happen more rapidly. And I'd like to bring in Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Camilla. Part 9 of the Act placed new duties on local authorities, and I just wondered if the Minister could set out what funding went alongside those new duties for councils to increase the provision of allotments in community growing spaces.
At the time of the passage of the Act?
At the time and then in subsequent years.
Well, I can't speak to at the passage of the Act, I'm afraid, just owing to not having been in government at the time, but I think that any additional statutory responsibilities placed on local authorities are borne in mind at the time when local government settlement is taken into account. And I know that'll be this year's settlement is something that this committee will be and is looking very closely at. But I suppose for the purposes of this Act, all I can say is that whenever the government or whenever legislation creates additional statutory responsibilities, that will be considered in part of the settlement because it's part of the core funding. We would expect local authorities to fund it from there.
Okay. And year on year, has there been any consideration given to increasing the allocation to local government to then allow them to increase the provision of allotments or community grown spaces?
Well, it's part of the block grant. So, again, it will be an assessment made of the responsibilities that are on local authorities, the extent to which they may have increased in any given year owing to legislation, and then the block grant is the final figure from which we would expect it to come. And I don't think I need to tell this committee about this year's block grant. I'm sure you're looking very closely at that.
Yeah. Okay. Just finally, convener, in Wales they have allocated additional funding for allotments, and you know why? It's clear to see the benefits you stated them in the statement. Wonder if the government is monitoring the impact that additional funding is having in Wales and whether they're considering following down that path.
Yeah, well, we always want to learn from neighbours far away and closer by as to how they're managing these things. And I was very interested in what the committee had, the evidence that you had taken in from Wales. And since your report, Scottish Government officials have met with their counterparts in the Welsh Government to discuss their commitment, how they think it's going. And we will absolutely seek to learn from what they have done. And I'll watch very closely to see how achievable the doubling is and how the funding's worked in that regard.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Mark. Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, convener. Good morning, Mary.
Morning.
Miles Briggs kind of asked the question I was hoping to probe with you, so I'll extend it a little bit more, if I may. It was really about potentially widening the scope of the Act to beyond local authorities, and you answered that. So I wonder if I could make the leap from this issue to wider issues in the Land Reform Bill, where one of the proposals is clearly to require those that are seeking to dispose of large-scale land and holdings and so on to give prior notice to communities. And so the inference from that is that perhaps communities get first dibs on potential transfers of land or sales of land. Is that a way, do you see, Minister, is that a way for communities to acquire parcels of land, pieces of land, for this purpose that we are talking about today?
Thank you. It's an interesting question, and certainly my experience so far is that there are a number of groups who have either formally used land reform legislation to acquire land for purposes including growing, or have been able to enter a negotiated sale because landowners now realise that there is a suite of legislation requiring this and it has that signalling effect. And of course that's supported by the Scottish Land Fund. The point about prior notice to communities, and the reason I think it's really important, is because it can be an onerous task, not just the point of constituting an appropriate body under the land reform legislation, but then going on to buy the land and to take it on. And the longer that communities have to prepare for that task, the more able they are in the end to take it right through to purchase and to managing it. So for me, the real value in pre-notification is giving time for communities to prepare, to navigate a sale, and to plan how they're going to manage the land thereafter. So it could be. Well, I think it already is helpful in the community growing space.
Do you think there's enough resilience within communities, you know, and given the time that they might need to consider such a transaction? Is there a sense that you have that communities will get first call on a land sale, or is that really not your intention behind the provisions of that section of the proposal?
No, it's absolutely about, firstly, believing that more people and more organisations should have the opportunity to own more land, and about giving communities as much time as possible to prepare for the purchase of it, if that's something that they want to pursue. Because it can, as I say, it is a substantial task, but I think that's probably right. I think that, you know, we believe that with rights come responsibilities. That goes for large landowners under land reform legislation, just as it does a community organisation looking to buy land. But the more time that they have and the more the support they have, which under land reform legislation is provided by the Scottish Government, the better.
Okay, thank you for that. Thanks.
Thanks. Is that support that they have, does that come their way when they enter into the Scottish Land Fund process?
It's not necessarily directly linked with the land fund, but community bodies can approach our community right to buy team and get guidance from them through the whole navigation of the land reform legislation.
Thank you. OK, we're nearing the end of our questions, but I'm going to bring Paul McLennan in.
Thanks, Camilla, and good morning, Marion.
Good morning.
And panel. Probably a couple of questions around about planning issues. Around about the first one is around about when does the Scottish Government anticipate being able to actively consider widening permitted development rights to incorporate allotments and other land for growing? That's the first one.
So I don't have a time that I can give you just now, except to say that the commitment to review is still ongoing, and the commitment to include allotments within that is the commitment is still there. I'm just wondering if Simon has any timeline that he could add to that. I don't think we do, but I should like to share it if we're able.
Thank you, Minister. Good morning, Committee. Good morning, Convener. You're absolutely right, Minister. There isn't a fixed timeline for when allotments will form part of the review, but you're absolutely right. The review is ongoing, and the phasing of the review remains itself under review as we progress with the work.
And I think there was some prioritisation given to local energy production just in light of the cost of living crisis and things like that. So.
Okay. Thank you for that. The second question, obviously we've just gone through the MPF4 process, and many local authorities are moving towards their local development plan processes. So does the government agree with the committee that food growing needs to be a category of land use included within frameworks such as local place planning? I think that's really pertinent, as I said, with a lot of local development plans now moving forward after MPF4.
I think, again, just owing to not being the planning minister, I might hand over to Simon initially for a view on that, and then if there's anything that I can add, I will do.
Thank you, Minister. Yes, so in relation to local place plans in particular, food growing is included in the guidance that we published earlier in 2022 about how to prepare a local place plan. And then in terms of local development plans, the content of those is informed by the National Planning Framework 4, as it will be, and local food growing and allotments is well covered within the policies within National Planning Framework 4. So we would anticipate that it would then feed down into the local development plans. In addition, the guidance that we consulted on about the preparation of local development plans included food growing as an issue that may be relevant for planning authorities to consider within the evidence report that is prepared at the early stage of the local development plan process. Thank you.
Simon, thank you for that. Thanks, Minister.
Thanks, Paul.
Thanks, Convener.
Thanks. Just coming back to land in terms of what's needed for allotments, has the Scottish Government calculated or would you consider calculating how much land is needed to meet demand? So we've got this big list and maybe we could be looking at how much land we actually needed. In particular, in our cities, Edinburgh and Glasgow, there's, as we know, these big lists. Has there been any work done in that way?
I think that would... My initial reaction to that, Convener, is that would certainly be something to be done at a local authority level. I think local authorities are best placed to respond not only to their own lists, which, you know, interestingly, I note in your report you say might actually not be accurate because some people might have gotten it or have moved or whatever. So there would be a bit of work for a local authority to do to make sure that the accuracy was there for the waiting lists themselves. But a mapping exercise as to the amount of land to meet that would certainly be something at a local level if it were to be done.
Perhaps it's something that we're both mutually doing in terms of the committee work and the Scottish Government work in terms of that signalling and that guidelines and the Scottish Government taking leadership in this direction. Thank you so much for the opportunity to hear from you today. I think it's been very helpful and we really appreciate you taking on board the work the committee has done. I think it's been a good collaboration in a sense.
Thank
in
you.
Terms of moving the allotment situation and the desire for people to grow food locally further forward.
Yeah.
I now suspend the meeting briefly while our witnesses leave the room. The third item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the budget scrutiny 2023-24. We'll be focusing our scrutiny on the budget for the Affordable Housing Supply Programme, which we explored in pre-budget scrutiny, and on the funding allocation for local government. We will hear from Shona Robison, Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government from the Scottish Government. And the Cabinet Secretary is accompanied today by Scottish Government officials, Kirsty Henderson from the Affordable Housing Supply Programme, who's the manager, and Katrina McKean, who's the head of Better Homes, and Ian Storey, who is the head of Local Government Finance. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting, and I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks for the opportunity to engage again with the committee. I think we're all too aware of the many challenges that people are currently facing, and since my last appearance here, I think it was back in September, we have put in place emergency legislation which has given people, whether they rent in the private or social rented sector, reassurance within their current tenancies through the worst of the winter, even as their other costs have unfortunately been rising. And of course, more recently, we have set out the Scottish Budget for 2023-24. We're using all the levers at our disposal to maximise investment and support people and the economy, targeting our spending as effectively as possible. The Scottish Budget 2023-24 sets out over £6.3 billion of capital spending to support employment and the economy through our large-scale infrastructure plans to move us along the path to net zero carbon emissions and to underpin the provision of quality public services. Our capital spending ambitions have been impacted by global trends, exacerbated by UK government decisions. And in light of inflationary pressures and the wider market conditions, we've made hard choices to reprioritise our 2023-24 capital budget to deliver against government priorities. In some cases, this has meant portfolio budgets have reduced when compared to May 2022 capital spending review publication. Where we've made choices to slow down or reduce available budgets, these are not choices that Scottish Government has taken lightly, but we have to ensure that we maximise the impact of our capital investment to deliver against our strategic priorities. But despite this, more than £3.5 billion will be available in this parliamentary term towards the delivery of more affordable homes. And in the most challenging budget settlement since devolution, we are providing over £13.2 billion in the 2023-24 local government finance settlement. Following the flat cash position set out in the resource spending review, we have listened to councils and are now increasing the resources available to local government next year by over £570 million, a real terms increase of £160.6 million or 1.3%. The 2023-24 local government finance settlement provides local authorities with £423.7 million of additional revenue funding for vital day-to-day services, which is a real terms increase of £39.1 million. The settlement also provides an increase in capital funding of £147.1 million, which is a real terms increase of £121.5 million. The 2023-24 budget has also baselined an additional £260.6 million for the 2022-23 local government pay deal. In addition to funding from the Scottish Government, local authorities have a range of revenue-raising powers that are not available to other public services, including full flexibility on council tax rate setting and the newly devolved powers over empty property rates relief. We'll also continue to work with our partners in local government to build on the COVID recovery strategy and agree an urgent approach to improve delivery of sustainable public services that are designed around the needs and interests of people and communities of Scotland. Another critical area of work has been the Short Life Task and Finish Group on the Cost of Living Tenant Protections Act 2022, which successfully concluded its work just before Christmas, when agreement was reached with the social sector on plans for social rents in 2023-24. COSLA and the SFHA have published statements setting out their members' intentions for rent in 2023-24. COSLA has committed to keeping local authority rent increase to an average of no more than £5 per week. And members of SFHA and Glasgow West of Scotland Forum of Housing Associations have reported planned increases average 6.1%. Finally, the use of average figures rather than a fixed cap allows for the flexibility to honour the outcomes of the statutory tenant consultations social landlords must undertake each year on rent setting. And this outcome ensures that tenants are protected from unaffordable rent rises whilst allowing social landlords to continue to invest in the delivery of more affordable homes where their business plans allow them to do so. These are just some updates on key areas and I look forward to exploring these and other issues that the committee may wish to discuss this morning. Thanks.
Thank you very much for the opening statement. I'll begin the questions around the Affordable Housing Supply Programme. At the previous session with the committee on the 27th of September, you told us that the Affordable Housing Supply Programme is a key priority for capital spend for the Scottish Government, so I am therefore confident about its position in any capital spending review. And I've heard what you said in your opening statement around capital spending being impacted by global issues and UK government choices. But I'd be interested to hear why the Affordable Housing Supply Programme capital budget has decreased by 19% in real terms next year.
OK, well, let me just, first of all, just say a little bit about that context, because it is important. We have seen, due to UK government decisions in the autumn statements, obviously the capital flow from the UK government to the Scottish government is the key lever in terms of what that quantum is. And we have seen a 3.4% real reduction in our capital allocation between 22-23 and 23-24. And in addition to that, obviously, is the impact of high inflation, which places significant additional pressure on the capital programme in terms of what it can deliver. I think we recognise as well that the flat and falling capital grant allocation that Scotland has received with that inflation really declines the buying power of that investment. So what the money we have can't go as far as we would like it to go. So that is the context. I think it's also important to say, though, that we have committed and remain committed to making more than £3.5 billion towards affordable housing over the current parliamentary period. And therefore, there was always going to be peaks and troughs of investment. And that, I think I've set that out before. The 23-24 budget for the Affordable Housing Supply Programme represents a net decrease of 4.7%, £36.87 million on the previous published capital spending review figure for 2023-24. And that is when you take into account financial transactions, the figure that you're left with is £36.87 million because there's been an increase in financial transactions. Now, what I would say is because of that priority and it being a key priority, we will be able to mitigate that circa £37 million reduction to some extent. Firstly, because there's going to be a £15 million in-year transfer from energy colleagues to help fund zero-emission heating systems. Secondly, the charitable bond donations generated from investment in bonds this year and the potential investment in 23-24 will also generate charitable donations that will be directed towards that social rented home investment. Now, it's difficult to put an absolute figure on it, but if we want to explore that further at some point, I'm happy to do so based on what the return was for the investment that we got last year. But it is sizeable. Therefore, taken together, those elements, I think, close the gap of that £37 million reduction to quite a large extent, actually. But the caveat to all of that is, even having said all of that and with all of that mitigation, the purchasing power of that investment is not going to be the same as it was 2-3 years ago. But we will obviously look to see what more we can do. And the sector is working hard around joint procurement, trying to drive down costs with off-site construction and innovative ways of really trying to make every pound go as far as possible. So in summary, convener, I mean, this is an area of huge importance to us. We are mitigating against that relatively small reduction, but the global amount of £3.5 billion commitment remains the same as it was.
Thank you very much for outlining that so clearly. I'd like to just go a little bit deeper. I mean, you already touched on the fact that you're going to be getting £15 million from the, I think, the energy budget, mm-hmm. and you talked about the bonds. But I'm interested to hear a little bit more detail in terms of the impact that this reduction might have in the affordable housing supply programme on the wider Scottish Government priorities, such as the outcomes that new affordable homes contribute to. So such as the net zero agenda, I imagine that energy piece, the money coming from the energy budget, helps there, but also reducing child poverty and supporting fragile rural and island communities with new affordable homes.
So you're right to point out that investment in affordable housing makes a really important contribution to tackling child poverty and the net zero agenda and reducing fuel poverty, obviously. And through our planned mitigations that have set out those kind of three areas of charitable bonds, financial transactions and the energy money transfer, we hope that there will be no negative impact on the delivery of affordable homes in 2023-24, although I think the most important impact is likely to remain being the global issues affecting construction that are impacting the pace of affordable housing delivery, inflation costs, interest rates, all of these. We are working closely with the construction industry and housing partners to mitigate these where possible. We operate a flexible grant system that can take account of increased costs, and that is a negotiation between the contractor and the social landlord, the housing association. And of course, we'll continue to collaborate with all our partners to achieve what is our shared goal of delivering more affordable homes for Scotland. I mean, it was always assumed, as I said at the beginning, that there will be peaks and troughs. Unfortunately, all of the factors bearing down on all forms of construction, not just house building and affordable house building, does mean that until things change, there will be less bang for bucks. But partners are working very, very hard to do that. But it has meant that there has been a slowdown in some of the delivery of projects, and that's been reflected, I think, in various locations across Scotland.
Thank you very much for those answers. I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey, continuing on the affordable housing theme.
Yep, thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. You've kind of partially answered the question I was about to ask. It was about the counterbalance effect and losing £37 million, but actually gaining 31, we think it is, through the financial transactions. Just for the benefit of the committee and the members, can you explain where the £31 million in financial transactions, the extra money, is actually coming from?
So I'll maybe get colleagues to come in on some of the detail of financial transactions, but financial transactions are available to the Scottish Government, and then it's for the Scottish Government to decide how it allocates those financial transactions. Now, because there are restrictions of how you can use financial transactions, housing has done quite well out of the availability of financial transactions when they have appeared, but they've fluctuated, so we don't really know well in advance what financial transaction availability through the UK government we're going to get. Comes quite late, so it's quite hard to plan a kind of 10-year investment around financial transactions, if you like. But when we do get notice of financial transaction availability. The Affordable Housing Supply Programme has generally done quite well out of that. So we've seen this year an increase of 17.6 million in financial transactions, which has helped around that balance of capital availability. I don't know if anybody wants to add anything on the FTs.
So I suppose the most important thing is that we're getting that money and we're able to direct it towards these schemes, you know, to help people into low cost home ownership and so on. Do you think there's a risk, though, Cabinet Secretary, that by encouraging that lower income households in that market, given the kind of volatility of the economy at the minute, is there a risk that we're perhaps encouraging people to enter the market that perhaps it's a bit difficult for them to maintain?
In terms of the open market shared equity scheme, I think the scheme works to reduce risk in that you have to meet certain criteria, obviously, in terms of being able to access the OMSI scheme. And I think it's right, therefore, that for those who are on low to moderate incomes who would not be able to afford to buy their home otherwise, that we do have that flexibility to support people to access the housing market. But it is important that the strict affordability criteria that's in operation of the scheme will hopefully mean that people wouldn't be getting access to the scheme if they were going to not be able to afford it. And they are encouraged to seek independent financial advice before taking out any shared equity agreement, in addition to any requirements that their own lenders may have, which they would have. Having said that, I think it would be remiss of me not to point out that whether you're in a rented property or you're paying your mortgage, with interest rates, inflation, the cost of living, everything bearing down on household costs, it does put pressure on every household budget. So, it's something we need to be very much alive to, but I think it's important that we do provide that opportunity to people who otherwise wouldn't have it.
Mm-hmm. And I suppose counter to that point, as a committee, we do hear about the particular problems faced by young single professional people who find it incredibly difficult to get anywhere near the home ownership housing market. Is the government aware of that? And do you think there's sufficient flexibility in all the models to try to reach out and assist them?
We are aware of that, and there have been changes to some of the levels that have been available, and they've been reviewed and they've been increased because of the recognition of that. There's a geographical variation as well. There are obvious hot spots that, despite all the pressures on the market, continue to be very buoyant and very difficult for people to access. But that's not uniform across the whole of Scotland. And there are options that we have seen expand, like mid-market rent, for example, which is still much more affordable than the private rented sector, which can be sometimes a good option for people who are in that position. I think there is undoubtedly a challenge for people in some areas of Scotland to get into the housing market, and indeed the rental market can be a challenge as well. And we are working with local authorities, particularly in those areas, to look at what innovative solutions they can bring forward. In Edinburgh, for example, we gave some additional money last year to the Affordable Housing Supply Programme that they had asked for. And we've asked them to come forward with some innovative solutions that we would look favourably upon in terms of how we could work with them to help deliver that. And I understand that they are working on some proposals.
OK, that's great. Thanks very much for that. Thank you.
Thanks, Willie. I'm now going to bring in Miles Briggs.
No, good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Good morning to your officials as well. Last week, Parliament agreed National Planning Framework 4, and I wondered, do you believe that the funding in this year's budget will be enough for affordable housing, which is the ambition for affordable housing within NPF 4?
Well, I certainly welcome the approval of NPF 4, and it's now about moving swiftly to adoption so that we can see a positive outcome from that for communities. NPF 4 is one part of the development plan, but an important part. And I think in addition to that, local place plans can now be brought forward by communities setting out their aspirations for their places. And I think that might help give communities maybe a bit more of a voice. It is more directive in shaping places with things like the infrastructure first approach, 20-minute neighbourhoods, for example, and the affordable housing contribution of at least 25% can be increased or indeed decreased based on local evidence. But I think in most places, the 25% is seen as the kind of floor. I can't think of many places that would want to reduce. I think they would have to have very strong arguments to reduce that contribution. It also contains proposed minimum all 10-year housing land requirements for each planning authority to meet the statutory requirement. I would hope that would mean that we could perhaps see more rapid development of particularly affordable housing projects within those areas. I think also Housing to 2040 and NPF are closely aligned in terms of the ambitions and have had to really consider had to be like cross consideration of both of those. So I think yes, but it's I guess as if anything in this world, it'll only be as good as it is used in practice, and we need to keep an eye on that, I think, to see what happens. Yeah.
Thank you for that, and I know it's something the committee's also keen to monitor, and we'll be returning to quite early on. You've already touched upon the rent freeze policy. I wanted to ask specifically, the committee's heard concerns that local housing associations across the country are rewriting their business plans. And so I just wondered what impact assessment has taken place on the social rented sector with regards to this below inflation increase which they'll see, and going forward, how this has destabilised them. And I think the committee welcome the fact that they have now been removed from this going forward, and something we as a committee had suggested, firstly, that they shouldn't have been there in the first place, but that they needed to be taken out of that.
So the agreement is a joint agreement. It's been negotiated very much with the sector, not to the sector, and I think that's important. And I think the certainty will do two things. First, it'll enable the sector to plan and get on with the new build developments and improvement programmes for existing homes, as well as the important support services they provide for tenants. And I think the second thing, though, is that when I speak to housing associations, and I'm sure it's the same for members of the committee, they always put affordability at the heart of their rent setting. And given the current context of where inflation's sitting, the rent increases that are proposed and have been agreed in terms of the average are well below forecast inflation rates, which means that rents in real terms will be reduced. And it has, I think, important to say that the voice of tenants is critical in deciding this, and housing associations are using the rent consultations, as they always do, to get that right balance between rents that are reasonable and proportionate and which allow for the ongoing investment in services and homes. Now, a big percentage of housing association and council tenants are will receive housing benefit and we recognise that and the sector recognises that, but they also recognise that there are people in low-income jobs that would struggle with inflation or above inflation rent rises. So they've had to take all of that into account. And one of the pledges that the sector has made is to really look at, and we want to work with them on this as well, about how we can provide additional support for tenants that are struggling with the rent. And I am particularly thinking about those who are low-income households but are out with receiving housing benefit. So I think, I think it gives the sector what they were looking for, and it means that they now have that certainty going forward.
Okay. Thank you for that. I wanted to move on to local government budget allocations and the financial challenges local authorities are reporting. And you've touched upon what the government argues is £570 million cash increase for local government. Now, this is a game I think every single budget we seem to be having, but COSLR are adamant that when you take into account all the policy commitments Scottish Government put onto local authorities, that increases £71 million. Do you accept that?
So, I hear what you say about the annual, he says, she says, and I think therefore it's important just to spend a moment going through some of the detail. So I think COSLA had initially claimed that the settlement had only increased by £70 million, and now I think they've been using a £38 million figure following confirmation that £32 million for teachers' pay in 2021-22 had been subsumed within the teacher numbers funding. The proposed budget to the in the allocation, and I guess you're comparing it with previous year, shows that the best like-for-like comparison, and I guess it's what you are comparing what with what, right? That's what I think it comes down to. It shows that for the like-for-like comparison of available funding at this stage in the budgetary cycle, adopting... COSLA's £38 million figure discounts funding for specific policy outcomes and doesn't reflect the £260.6 million, I think it was, for the 2022-23 pay that's now baselined. So it's important that that is recognised. Now, just because COSLA and local authorities already know about this baseline funding doesn't mean that it can be or should be ignored. So again, it comes back to what it is you are including, and it is additional funding to what they received in the last budget and supports the delivery of local services. Not least, you could argue very much that that pay, that the vast bulk of local authorities spend, as any public service, is about pay. So I think it's entirely fair to include that that money. So I guess it comes down to that, what it is you include and what it is you don't include. So we would maintain that it's factually correct that the local government settlement has increased by over £570 million in cash terms. In addition to that, there's also the additional spending power offered through the budget. We're preserving funding provided before the national insurance increase, and that's despite its reversal by the UK government, offering full flexibility over council tax and including financial gains from the poundage freeze. In addition, there's the local visitor levy billed to Parliament this year, giving discretionary powers. There is an appetite, I think, to also look at what else can be done around fiscal flexibility and indeed other revenue raising powers as we go on, albeit that won't impact on this coming year's budget. And, you know, I'm sure at some point we might touch on things like the fiscal framework and New Deal. But I guess that, in short order, is why there is a differing version, if you like, of the budget, because it depends what you include and what you don't. But I think not including pay is a bit of a stretch, to be honest, and that's why we've included it, and that's the figure we get to. Is that a good enough summary, Ian?
I think, if I may, the one thing I would add is that the 517th Parliament dictates that budget comparisons in the budget document must be from budget to budget. Yes. So that's a matter of parliamentary demand to assist scrutiny. And if we were to add things in that come in at the autumn budget revision and things, those comparisons would be absolutely impossible for Parliament to, and indeed for us, to deal with. So I think the 570 is a matter of objective fact, and it's set out on the face of the budget. As Ms Robertson said, the 70 million presentation is a slightly more subjective assessment. That doesn't mean it's not right, but it's a subjective assessment, and it does exclude funding that is allocated for local services. And again, that's COSLA's perfectly within their rights to see that as not within their full flexibility. But the funding absolutely categorically does go to local government services, and it's consistent with parliamentary presentation for the previous 20 years.
Thank you for that. And I think the differing versions will continue throughout this process from COSLA and others going forward. I just finally wanted to ask a question with regards to any plan to review the funding formula for local authorities. The Cabinet Secretary's touched upon pressures in Edinburgh. They are acute, if not in crisis, with regards to affordable housing, homelessness, and Edinburgh is one, if not the lowest funded local authority. So I just wondered if the Cabinet Secretary had anything to add on that during this budget process.
Well, Ian will keep me right, but that is really a matter for COSLA in terms of the funding formula. And, you know, where there, I think over the years, have been some adjustments to the funding formula, it is a thorny issue among local government itself. And I think there is probably quite a lot of hesitance, I would say, within COSLA and local government more widely to open up that particularly Pandora's box, because there'll be winners and losers out of any adjustment to the formula. So it's not something we can do to local government. This would have to be initiated by COSLA. If what you're asking me is if COSLA and local government were to pitch up saying they wanted to have a look at this again, then, you know, we certainly wouldn't stand in the way of reviewing the formula, but it would really have to be led by them. I think that's the position, really.
Absolutely the position. Every decision on distribution is taken with the jointly chaired settlement and distribution group, which meets on a monthly basis and indeed meets again tomorrow. So every decision on distribution is taken on the basis of a needs-based assessment, and it's when you collide those all back into the big distribution formula that some of the nuances start to appear. And as Ms Robson has said, it's effectively distribution as a zero-sum game. So to revisit the formula, you are going to create winners and losers, and on that basis, it's important that any proposed changes come from COSLA in the first instance.
So it's a bit of a stalemate then, if they're not willing to bring that forward?
I think we're quite keen to keep it as a live discussion. I think it's a constant discussion as to whether the current formula is the most accurate way to distribute funding, and I would like to think that will be a permanent feature of the formula.
Thank you. Thanks, Camina.
I'm now going to bring in Mark Griffin with questions.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning.
Morning.
All 32 directors of finance had written to the Scottish Minister setting out what they felt were over £1 billion of additional budget pressures to local government for 23-24. I just wonder, Cabinet Secretary, if you've had the chance with your officials to meet with directors of finances to discuss the assessment of what the makeup of that £1 billion is, and then compare it against the budget allocation for next year to see whether you feel that that allocation meets the pressures that they set out?
So there's regular dialogue with various people within local government, and so the Cabinet Secretary for Finance, Deputy First Minister, will meet on a regular basis with various local government representatives, as do I. It tends to be with the presidential team of COSLA, or in my case, I've spent a lot of time meeting housing conveners, for example, directly. Obviously, we have, so we are well aware of the points that you have put forward, and there's been quite extensive correspondence around these matters. Let me say a couple of things. One is, I don't think anyone in the room is going to say otherwise that, you know, finances are challenging and difficult, and that is for all parts of the public sector, and local government is no exception to that. Now, just to put some context to the billion pound ask, if you took the consequentials for next year in 2023 for local authority and education spending in England, and bearing in mind this is where Barnett consequentials flow from, they were circa 242 million net of national insurance contributions reversal. So to be blunt, if we were trying to meet that billion pound ask, we would have to go well beyond what the Barnett allocation for local government has been from the UK government. In addition, the global resources coming from the UK government, Ian, I think we're circa about 800 million.
I believe it was slightly more than that.
Slightly more than 800 million. So, again, to be blunt, that would have required us to give not just every penny that was coming from the UK government for all services, we would have to have found money in addition to that. So, the reason I'm saying that is that it was an ask that was just impossible to have ever met. So what could we do? Well, what we did was to look at the art of the possible, and that is where the 570 million, a real terms increase of 160.6 million or 1.3%, was found, and that meant making some difficult decisions, not least on pay and then baselining the pay. That money all has to come from somewhere. So I hear what local government in its various articulations have said, but we have genuinely tried to do what we can within a very, very tight fiscal environment.
Yep. I appreciate what the Cabinet Secretary says about, you know, the political and financial cost of meeting that ask. My question was more about the assessment of the quantum of the ask, whether that was a reasonable ask or not. But I suppose,
well, I guess you could say that any public service will want to ask for the maximum that they, you know, but I think realise, and I think those directors of finance would also realise that, you know, that difficult decisions are going to have to be made across the public sector. And I think it's interesting in terms of the Accounts Commission, of what they said. And first of all, they recognised the 570 million figure, which was helpful, but they also talked about the two things. They said that there would need to be reform and looking at building on the COVID recovery strategy and doing things differently. And they also pointed to perhaps needing to review the use of reserves and what those reserves are used for. And I also hasten to add that I totally accept that some of those reserves have already been committed, but I think it's always good to keep these things under review. So, if we were sitting here talking about the health service would also say, you know, we would, in an ideal world, we would want X, but if X isn't available, it's then what is the art of the possible within constraints on funding across the board.
Okay, as well as the, you know, setting out the billion pound budget pressures, the directors of finance also set out what they felt the impact of not meeting those pressures would be, and that would be services reducing, stopping, or, you know, staff numbers going down. We've seen examples of that with local authorities starting to produce their saving packages, and some of them being pretty severe. I just wondered what assessment there has potentially been of those 32 various savings packages that are emerging and what the impact is going to be on other public services, say health or social care, as a result of reducing services being available that were previously provided by local authorities.
And I don't think we can shy away that it will be difficult decisions that will have to be made across the public sector, not just local government. And that I think the Accounts Commission were pointing out that when you look at the profiling of the budget set out by UK government, years 3 and 4 look particularly challenging. So this year and next year would be the time, even though things are tough, it would be the best time to look at reforms, how services could be delivered differently. Are there some services that could be shared while maintaining a no compulsory redundancy policy, which I think local most councils, if not all councils, have committed to doing. So it will mean having to look at how things are done differently. But if you take the quantum of the budget we have and how we have allocated that, bearing in mind inflationary pressures, we have tried to do what we can to give local government a fair settlement in the circumstances, but recognise it is probably the most challenging budget settlement since devolution, because it's not just about the quantum of money, it's about the inflationary pressures, the pay pressures, all of that, which heap problem upon problem on an already stretched budget. So, we've tried to set out our rationale. We've obviously used our tax raising powers to raise additional monies to put towards the NHS in particular. And we'll continue to discuss with other parties as well, what other options people feel could be brought to the table. But there are no easy answers here at all.
Okay, finally, Convener, the budget shows that I think it's 12% of local government's budget is from in-year transfers from other budgets. Mm-hmm. Now, that's £1.5 billion, that's significant. I just wonder if you could set out in a bit more detail what the makeup of that £1.5 billion is and what the proportion of that spend is directed spend, and what proportion local government can spend freely on whatever they see fit.
Yeah, I think the first thing to say is that councils have autonomy over 93% of their funding, so that's about £12.3 billion of funding for 23-24. In terms of the other Scottish Government portfolios, I can give you some examples. There's quite a list. I can write to the committee with the full list if that would be helpful, but it includes, for example, a new £22 million for additional adult social workers, a new £32 million to support families stay together and reduce the number of children in care through the Whole Family Wellbeing Fund, a new £2.4 million for local heat and energy efficiency strategies, additional £100 million for health and social care to support the increase in real living wage, an increase of £16 million for free school meals, £521.9 million to support the expansion in funded early learning and childcare. There's quite a list, but those, I guess, are I think I'm just being told the list is in table 5.16 of the budget document, but we can write as well if that would be helpful. There's also additional capital, £80 million for free school meals, for some of the infrastructure costs. So, but having said that, you will be aware of the discussions that we are having with local government about increasing flexibility. I think that is the right discussion to be having. I guess the thing that we would need to find a way forward on is confidence of some of the priorities being delivered if it's not through ring fencing. Because, as you'll know from time in the chamber, it's quite often Scottish Government ministers that are being asked about the delivery of policies that are that local government deliver. So, you know, we would need assurance about those joint priorities if we were to move away from ring fencing around some of these matters. But I think, from my own portfolio interests, including local government, that I'm very much in favour of trying to do that, but we need to do it in a properly organised way.
Okay, thanks, Kimmerer.
Thanks, Mark. I'm now going to bring in Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Kimmerer. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. We've kind of obviously talked about the impact of inflation and so on. This is talking about the affordability of capital projects, particularly on councils that have been obviously impacted by inflation, increases in interest rates and the cost of materials and labour. How can the Scottish Government help councils ensure continued investment in council stock, including schools and housing?
Yeah, clearly inflation impacts on every part of public sector investment, including local government. I think it is important that we have the ability, in housing, for example, that there is some flexibility around the contracts to be able to keep projects coming through and enable them to be delivered. Capital investment through local government and other public bodies provides important stimulus to the local economy, so we recognise the importance of it. I think we need to think about innovation. So one of the areas in housing that has got a lot of potential, two actually. One would be joint procurement and perhaps really trying to pull spending power around negotiations for whether that's for materials or perhaps doing things on a more joint basis across the housing sector, looking at more off-site construction because again there are efficiencies because it's all year round build. So the kind of interruptions of winter are not as profound when you're using off-site construction, but it's an area that probably needs to expand, and I would hope that the cost per unit may also come down if there were those economies of scale of large-scale purchase through the affordable housing project. So I think that those are two. There are other areas as well that can be looked at, but those, I think, have the opportunity to drive forward efficiencies in making sure we get as much return for the money invested.
Okay. Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. I might have a question on the fiscal framework, but I know we're moving on to that later on, so I'll maybe come in that one, but thanks for that.
Thanks, Paul. Marie, you wanted to come in.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and your officials. The Deputy First Minister, during his budget statement, confirmed that councils will have full flexibility to set the council tax rate that's appropriate to the local area. Was there any consideration given to negotiating a council tax freeze again this year? And what levels of increase do the Scottish Government expect to see in council tax rates next year?
Firstly, on whether a council tax freeze would have been right, or I don't think it would have in the current financial context. And it has been a policy that was appropriate for the time it was appropriate, but in the current financial climate, I think that would have been very difficult to justify. As you know, council tax is by nature, it's a local tax, and quite rightly it's set and administered by individual local authorities. So, the setting of that is a local democratic choice, and the level at which they need to be accountable to constituents for that. And I would hope in the midst of a cost of living crisis some cognizance would be taken of that in terms of affordability of the local population. So maybe just also worth noting that despite increases. Council tax is generally lower in Scotland than elsewhere. I think the average Band D charge in Scotland is £619 less than in England and £430 less than in Wales. So by comparison, I think people are still having lower levels of local taxation than perhaps elsewhere in these islands. So ultimately, as I say, it's for local authorities to justify to their local population where they end up landing on council tax.
Thank you. Staying in the issue of flexibility then, councils within my constituency, East and West Northamptonshire, have indicated that they're considering a range of budget cuts. And like a lot of members, I'm concerned about the proposals and I want to see councils getting the best support from the budget settlement and maximum flexibility. I know we've already touched on this, but can you assure the committee that the Scottish Government will consider requests made by councils for maximum flexibility and how they apply the budget allocations from the Scottish Government? And can you assure the committee that discussions will continue with COSLA on the scale and scope of the settlement?
Well, on the last point, I mean, I need to be totally honest that there is no more money on the horizon because there's no more money on our horizon and there's no kind of magic pot of money that is hidden away somewhere. It is absolutely not the case. And, you know, I think for the first time in a long time, there was very limited, if any, carry forward for the Scottish Government. So, you know, these are really challenging times. In terms of flexibility, yes. I guess go back to the exchange with Mark Griffin. You know, there's a balance to be struck there. I think it's right that the presumption is about let's maximise flexibility, particularly in these challenging times. But you will have heard, as I do, that Scottish ministers are often asked and held to account for the delivery or otherwise of local government around key shared priorities. So that is the kind of the important bit that we need to get right, is what is the accountability and the trust and confidence that ministers would have, whether it's in education or, you know, housing or whatever, that if ring fencing was removed, what are the commitments that are going to be made that will remain a priority? And if I think of some discrete areas in my own portfolio, like homelessness investment, for example, a really, really important investment that's been made in Housing First and ending homelessness. And, you know, I would want, as a minister responsible for that, assurance that remains a priority and that the funding, the appropriate funding, will be made in order to deliver on the commitments made. So those are all part of the discussions that we continue to have, and I think will be the core of new fiscal framework going forward, the New Deal, to try and get that balance right, because we don't want to micromanage local authorities, but we do want to have some confidence and assurance that when we agree priorities to actually make people's lives better and improvements, that we see some delivery of that through whatever partner that we're working with.
I share your concerns there. Just one further comment. The Scottish Government have acknowledged there's many pressures on council budgets beyond its control. Obviously, we've mentioned already, like inflation, fuel cost, COVID-19 recovery, etc. But one council in my area have highlighted the repaying of the PPP projects, have saddled them with debt for now over 60 years. Do you have any indication of a Scottish-wide cost for these schemes, and how much is it costing the Scottish Government in the way of grant support to councils? And if you don't have any figures today, can you possibly write to the committee with that? It would be really helpful.
Yes, I mean, I certainly recognise the point, and it is a long-term financial commitment that local authorities are tied into, and some of the deals that were done, particularly in the early days, were a very, very poor value for money for the public purse. And the longevity of some of those deals is quite eye-watering. I'm happy to write to the committee with that figure. I don't have it to hands. I do recall it being used in the chamber recently, but I can't recall what the figure was. So I'll write with the latest figure available.
Thank you. Really appreciate your comments.
Thanks, Maria. Yes, that would be welcome to have that information. I just wanted to pick up on council reserves. In 2021 to 22, almost three quarters of councils, 23 of them, reported an increase in usable reserves. However, local authorities have been forced for many years to supplement general grant revenue funding with reserves to prevent cuts to highly valued community facilities and services. And this is, of course, not what reserves should be used for, yet local authority funding levels have resulted in the necessity to do so. I think the committee would be interested to hear from the Cabinet Secretary if you believe that local authorities should be drawing on these reserves, and if so, in what circumstances?
Well, look, ultimately, these are decisions for councils to make. And, you know, I totally accept that, you know, once reserves are spent, they're spent, so they can only be spent once. And I do also accept that, you know, some reserves will be earmarked for things that and may have been earmarked for quite some time. I think, though, like any public organisation, you know, you would expect local authorities or any other organisation that has reserves to hand to keep their current priorities under review and to make sure that if something was, I don't know, maybe a priority 5 years ago and the reserves had been earmarked for that, these things should always be kept under review to look at whether in the current financial climate or current competing priorities, what is the most important use of those reserves. So, you know, I think that would really be my main point, other than, you know, money is money and, you know, the judgments have to be made about the appropriate use. But in a cost of living crisis, and I know some local authorities are already doing this, you know, to support people through the most difficult of times, that the, you know, reserves can play an important role. Plus, the point we were talking about earlier on reform. Sometimes the impediment to reform can be trying to keep the existing show on the road while trying to do things differently. And reforming services, actually, you know, reserves can be very useful in that context as well, because you can have a sort of twin-track approach to reform services to make improvements and better value for money. So, but ultimately, these are decisions for councils to make, but I'm sure these are some of the discussions that are being had.
I imagine they certainly are. We're going to move on to the New Deal and for local government and the local governance review and a few questions in that area. And I think the committee would be interested to receive an update on the progress towards agreeing a New Deal with local government. In November, the Minister for Local Government and Social Security informed the committee that a deal will be agreed in advance of the next financial year. That's quite soon. Is this still going to be the case? And if so, why were there so few details of the New Deal in the budget document?
Well, I think it's fair to say that, you know, the last 6 months have seen a big focus on things like cost of living crisis, the pay deals, the budget, and, you know, we now really want to turbocharge the focus, I think, on the New Deal. There's a number of discussions taking place. There was a number towards the end of the year and a number this month at ministerial level to really try to move things forward. We also know that, you know, COSLA and SOLAS have been clear that they want to get it right and they would rather not rush and get it right and take time. And I think probably that's on balance the right judgment. If it's going to stand the test of time, then if it takes a few more months to get it right, then I think that's probably the right call, to be honest.
Thank you for that. I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much again, Convener. Cabinet Secretary,
I was first elected as a local councillor in 1992. And every year, as night follows day, there's a one-fight argument every year about ring fencing and so on and so forth. And we've touched on it today. Do you think there's new life to be breathed into that debate, perhaps in the New Deal, that could attempt to resolve that dispute every year? Because when the public look at this and perhaps read the debates going on, they can't cut through all the figures. It's incredibly difficult and complex for the public to, maybe even to decide who's right and who's wrong. And you've heard some examples of it even today. So do you think there might be a little bit of effort, do you think, in the New Deal negotiations to try to resolve that particular issue, or will we just enjoy it annually forevermore?
I mean, it would be good to get away from that, wouldn't it? I mean, I guess we had previously we had the Concordat, which actually did have a very different way of delivering services, in that there was almost the entire ring fencing was done away with at that point. However, I think it's fair to say that that there has perhaps not been the delivery in some quarters of some of the priorities, can be as kind of gentle as that. So the question is, as we've touched on a couple of occasions through this session, what could be done that strikes the right balance between maximising flexibility but having that accountability for what is spent on and what. Now, there might be some issues around what you've said there around the transparency of what's spent on what and how that's done. I think is part of the discussion that needs to be made. But so if you go back to homelessness, I think there'd be no one in this room, probably no one really generally in local government and elsewhere, that would say that homeless this investment in services is not a priority, but it's a discrete amount of funding. So I would need some assurance that if it's not that discrete pot of funding that's for that purpose and it goes into a bigger pot, but homelessness is an agreed priority for all of us, how does that then translate to what's delivered within that local authority on homelessness services? Because it's a really important discrete area of work that supports some of our most vulnerable people. So that's one example of, so we need to track that out and discuss about, well, what might that look like that gives all of us the assurance that we need so that, if there's questions in the chamber on homelessness, that I've got some assurance and confidence that what I'm saying about delivery on homelessness services is actually the reality on the ground. So these are the types of discussions that we need to have, and we need to get it right, and it needs to be able to last the long term so that we can get away from what you've described as being kind of interminable kind of annual discussions. And that's not to say that local priorities are not important. They are, and for each local authority will have perhaps, quite rightly differing priorities, and that's not to cut across that at all. But, there will be agreed priorities. The COVID recovery plan maybe points the way to some degree that there was all kind of shoulders to the wheel against clear objectives and joint priorities. There may be some lessons in that around how we can use that learning to apply it to other areas.
It was nice to hear you reminisce about the historic Concordat in 2007. There, it was very nice to hear that again. But the narrative, Cabinet Secretary, around ring fencing tends to be kind of negative. It's as if the impression is that we're forcing councils to do things they don't want to do. But these are shared priorities, we understand. Do you think we might try to get into that kind of discussion so that it's not seen as directive from on top to do things that local authorities might not actually want to do? They, in fact, share these priorities with the government, don't they?
I think you're right. There's very few, I can't really think of any, that wouldn't be shared priorities. And I think there are some sensible kind of changes that need to be made, not just for local government, incidentally, but I think third sector as well, where we sometimes require quite onerous reporting for relatively small amounts of money, and that's really not in anybody's interest. So we need to have a sensible set of arrangements that strikes the right balance and allows, you know, the movement of money where that needs to happen. And there may be times where things are underspent for a variety of good reasons, and, you know, so we need to be aware and of that. So, but I'm hopeful that we can make progress.
And on the point that you mentioned yourself, you gave a few examples of how there's more flexibility within local government to raise their own revenue. You mentioned you cited a couple of examples there. Is that a journey that you would see continuing, that we would hope to give more flexibility to local authorities? Because our understanding is that other jurisdictions across Europe have more of an ability to raise revenues locally than perhaps councils do in Scotland. So is that kind of direction of travel one that you support and you would hope to develop in the future?
Yes, definitely, but it will take time. Sometimes something sounds very simple and straightforward, but nothing ever is, and it always takes a bit longer to put things in place and for, you know, to get it right. But on the principle of it, absolutely, and I think we would welcome a dialogue with local government around some ideas that they might have beyond what's already on the table and being agreed around different ways of raising revenue. That might be different from, you know, the city authorities to the rural ones. I think there has to be a recognition that, you know, 32 local authorities are all quite different in nature and priorities and populations. But the principle of it, yes, I don't see why not.
Mm-hmm. And lastly, for me, just on the issue about certainty and multi-year funding announcements and arrangements, is that becoming an embedded approach that the Scottish Government will hope to continue to take, so that local councils can plan ahead for 2-3 years rather than this annual preparation and planning that sometimes is subject to volatile changes in the economy? So is that something you prefer to stick with, multi-year settlements providing that level of certainty?
Yes, and the fiscal framework is really key here, and it, you know, really intended to establish a new fiscal relationship with, you know, not just multi-year budgets, but, you know, established agreed ways of working, including how local governments engage in the budget process, and that might offset some of the issues we talked about earlier, greater flexibility, improved accountability, and I think, you know, where we can, we absolutely should, and not just for a local government. We mentioned the third sector earlier on, and I think giving certainty to them around multi-year funding would be a major step forward, and, you know, discussions are going on about how that could work.
Okay, thanks very much for that. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Willie. I'm going to bring Paul McClellan in with a supplementary.
Yeah, thanks, Convener, and thanks, CabSec. I think I kind of touched on this before. At the Social Justice Committee, I'd asked the DFM around about the fiscal framework discussions that are going on between the Scottish Government and UK Government at this time, and whether more flexibility would assist probably the committee and a demand-led service. I suppose local government and housing is demand-led. So I don't know if there's any thoughts on the round about the discussions that are ongoing at the moment between UK and Scottish governments about flexibility that might help your portfolio. Have you got any comments on that at all?
Do you mean in terms of financial framework, in terms of borrowing powers?
Yeah,
and
additional borrowing powers, or anything else you think would be useful, in that? Because I think we then discussed it within the Social Justice Committee in that regard.
Well, I mean, we know, for example, that the Social Security budget is a great example of how that agreement doesn't work, and the limitations on borrowing powers is just a major impediment exposed hugely through COVID and then a cost of living crisis. So, as a matter of urgency, those are issues that really do need to be opened up. And, you know, if we can get that opened up and a different budget settlement for the Scottish Government in terms of those flexibilities and borrowing powers, that has a knock-on benefit to parts of the public sector. So it's really very important.
The additional borrowing powers would assist what's going on within the sector, for example, around about housing and talked about the moment inflation increase.
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you. Thanks.
Thank you, Paul. And what would we need to do to get that opened up?
Well, discussions have been muted, but they're not in any way at a detailed level, Ian, as far as I'm aware. There has been an agreement to talk, but there has not been much detail around any progress being made specifically, but happy to again drop a note on kind of what the latest position is. I would like to think, and maybe I'm being entirely optimistic here, that the UK government perhaps recognises the point, and that might be a good starting point to recognise the point and the fact that the arrangements that have been around for over 20 years are now waning a bit thin and are not fit for purpose. So,
thank you for that.
I'll write, or I'll get maybe ask DFM to write.
Yeah, that would be very helpful. I'm going to bring Miles. I believe you wanted to come
thank
in
you
on this.
That. Yeah, just further to the questions and answers which you've given to both Willie and to Paul. I wondered, with regards to the National Care Service, what COSLA have been outlining their concerns around, where it currently sits, and where actually all the budget pressures which you've outlined this morning, there's an opportunity to pause, to look at that and to allocate the resources attached to that now to local government, so that that funding goes to the front line now and it's not being used, and to look again at what's happening with that policy.
I mean, firstly, on just on the budget, I think I mentioned earlier on there was 100 million for health and social care to support the increase in the real living wage, as well as more funding for social care in the round in terms of the deal, because at the moment it's still local government delivering social care, so that's important. I mean, I think as we move forward, I mean the we absolutely are committed to the principle of delivering a national care service. We'd like to work with COSLA and local government in doing that, but we understand and hear their reservations, and we need to work through those. And part of doing that, I think, will be trying to work with perhaps those local authorities that are keen to make progress, to demonstrate how things can be done in a different way. I don't think anybody could say that the current arrangements, and I was a big advocate of integration and I had high hopes and expectations. I know as a former home care organiser, I probably know far more about this than I ever wanted to, in terms of the interaction between health and social care and some of the blockages in the system, and integration was, I think, an attempt that everybody had a lot of hope for to overcome some of those barriers, but it just hasn't delivered in the way that I think all of us had hoped and aspired to. So doing nothing and making no change is not an option. The National Care Service, I think, have delivered it correctly, and it will take time to get that right. I think can deliver a better deal for people who are receiving care. And when you hear what they have to say, there are very, very strong views in favour of reform and change.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Camina.
Thanks, Miles. And we're now going to go to a question from Annie Wells, who's joining us online.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, you did touch on service reform in that previous answer to Mark Griffin. And as you'll know, the recent Accounts Commission Local Government Financial Bulletin, the Commissioner, William Moyes, stated that if councils are to find a safe path through the difficult times ahead, they need to focus on more service reform. And based on strong engagement with communities, what more can the Scottish Government do to assist councils in this process?
Thanks for the question. And I think maybe just firstly to say it's not just local government that needs to look at service reform. I think we need to look across the public sector about how can we do things differently. And that's not about a diminution or reduction in quality of service, but it is a recognition that if you look towards years 3 and 4 of this budget cycle, continuing business as usual is just really not an option given the reductions in resources that will be coming to the Scottish Government. So really now, the next couple of years, is the time to be looking at how that reform could happen. And the Accounts Commission have said, you know, likewise, that local government needs to be part of the story there and is a huge part of the public sector landscape. And you, when you think about the interaction, whether we've just been touching on local government and health, but there's, you know, interaction between local government and other public services, and interaction between local authorities in terms of on a regional basis. And I think we need to have a rapid dialogue, and it is a dialogue. It's not for us to tell local government how they should reform. It needs to be a dialogue, first of all, probably primarily among local government, about the appetite for reform and for change. But I certainly think there is an appetite within the Scottish Government to support that type of thinking. And if we can be of assistance to local government and indeed other parts of the public sector, then we're keen to do so.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Annie. We have a little time on hand, so I'm just going to loop us back to the affordable housing conversation. Mm-hmm. And I just wanted to pick up on rural housing. The reduction in budget for the affordable housing supply programme will likely add to increasing pressure on landlords and local authorities to provide sufficient housing in their communities. And therefore, I'm keen that we support community-led developments to complement our national efforts to tackle the rural housing crisis. And through the work I've been doing in my region, it has become clear the vital role that community housing enabling organisations play. Mm-hmm. I'm aware of around 600 projects in my region across 150 communities that are in a pipeline process. Right. And the work that the enablers are doing is work that's very much, in a way, what you're talking about in terms of, you know, the reform piece you've been talking about. Kind of like, it's work that needs facilitation, time. It's about bringing the communities to a place where they really understand if they have the capacity and the confidence to take the leap to take forward housing, which is quite an onerous thing to do. I'd be interested to hear how this budget supports rural housing enablers to support communities in taking action on the housing crisis that they are experiencing.
Well, first of all, let me recognise your interest in this, and I know that you've we've certainly had a number of discussions about the importance of affordable housing delivery and development, and not just in urban Scotland, but very much in remote and rural and island Scotland as well. And you'll be aware of the developing Remote, Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan, which I see as a really important milestone in getting an understanding of the blockages, some of which you've just articulated, and more importantly, how we overcome those. We expect to have a full plan in the spring, and the important consideration within that is the role of the Community Housing Trust movement, and we've obviously given a commitment to look at how they can be supported in the work that they do. Now, one of the areas that has been identified, and it's not an easy one to resolve, is that kind of early stage development phase. And I think that's something that the plan needs to look at and look at how that can be addressed. And I think the Community Housing Trusts have a really important role there. I mean, not least that sometimes in very, very small developments, resolving community differences, keeping people on board, working through some quite tricky issues, quite often they are well placed to be able to help and lead that work. So very much recognise the point you're making, convener, and you know, I'm hoping that the contents of the plan will help to move forward these issues.
Thank you very much for that. I'll look forward to seeing the plan in the spring, and obviously this really connects into the government's commitment to also maintaining our rural populations in place.
Yeah, definitely.
Thank you very much for coming today and giving us your evidence, responding to our questions. I think it's been very helpful to the committee to hear a bit more detail on the thinking behind the budget allocation. As we agreed at the start of the meeting to take the remainder of our agenda items in private, we have no more public business today, and I now close the public part of the meeting.